Hey there, everyone. Welcome to Secret Plus, where we pick one topic and hyper-focus on it. I'm your host, Julian Huguet, and I want to ask you, have you ever packed for a long trip? You know, you've checked the weather forecast for wherever you're going, and you brought the appropriate wardrobe. Your suitcase is full of Hawaiian shirts and short shorts that really show off the goods. And then a week into the trip, you're caught in a snowstorm and cursing the weather channel. Has that ever happened to you? Okay, maybe not so much since 2020 with the pandemic shutting down everyone's vacation plans, which incredibly actually made weather forecasts worse. Apparently, meteorologists used data from commercial flights to help predict weather, and since people weren't traveling, they just didn't have as much data to work with, which was something I had no idea about. In fact, I didn't know a lot about the weather, so for this series, I wanted to explore it. We're going to unpack everything about the weather, why it seems the forecast is always wrong, what it takes to maybe control the weather, and the big enchilada, terraforming other planets. But first, let's dig into why meteorologists seem to get the weather wrong so often and still manage to keep their jobs. I mean, can you imagine if you had that sort of leeway at your work? Really, though, we should be giving these people a break. I know, controversial, hot take, but forecasting the weather is pretty hard stuff, to put it mildly. Meteorologists have to look at real-time data from numerous sources like weather balloons, buoys, radar, and satellites, and make predictions about what might happen next. And even with all that data, there's always some uncertainty. The weather is inherently unpredictable, and meteorologists try to provide order for that chaos. In fact, a key principle in chaos theory, the butterfly effect, has its origins in weather forecasting. Now, I know, when I say chaos theory, you're going to think of Jurassic Park and Jeff Goldblum and not the weather. But hey, sometimes real life just isn't as sexy as T-Rexes and Dr. Ian Malcolm. I mean, what is as sexy as Dr. Ian Malcolm? I'm sorry, I was getting lost in a daydream a little bit. The term butterfly effect, though, was coined in the 60s by meteorologist Edward Lorenz. The idea goes that small changes to initial conditions can have large consequences down the road. The saying you're probably familiar with is, if a butterfly flaps its wings on one side of the world, it can cause a hurricane on the other side. But that's not how the effect got its name. It actually relates to the resulting shape of a graph that Lorenz made when he plotted points to an equation that represented the motion of gas. These plotted points kind of look like a butterfly's wings, and they show that small changes can make big differences. But the outcomes aren't totally random. Whatever happens still has to be within the realm of possibility. So ironically, that whole butterfly causing a hurricane shtick, it's not a possible outcome of the butterfly effect. I mean, at least I'm pretty sure, but you'd have to ask a meteorologist to double check. Anyway, this graph, by the way, is called a strange attractor, which is my signature move when I go to a bar. Lorenz came up with this graph when he was working on an experiment to model a weather prediction, and he rounded off one number at the starting point of the model. He found that this minor change could result in anything from sunny skies to violent storms. And Lorenz concluded that the further out you try to predict the weather, the more unreliable the forecast becomes. Even 60 years later, predicting a 10-day forecast or longer is still only right about half the time. Now, that may be one reason why meteorologists get blamed for getting the weather wrong so much of the time, but there's more to the story. Sometimes, it comes down to which allegiance meteorologists swear to. I mean, I'm kind of exaggerating, but not really. There are two choices, and meteorologists have to pick one. I mentioned weather models earlier, right? Well, today, meteorologists largely rely on two major modeling systems, the American model and the European model. Both run on some of the fastest supercomputers in the world. They handle tons of variables for things like temperature and pressure and gather millions of measurements to help handle the initial conditions of the atmosphere. Between the two of them, most forecasters actually agree that the European system is a tad more accurate, mainly because it has a more powerful supercomputing system and can really focus on medium-range forecasts. Those are the forecasts between 3 and 7 days. Let's look at a famous example in 2012 when the two systems were both used. The European model accurately predicted Hurricane Sandy's path westward more than a week in advance, But the American counterpart predicted that it would move east away from the coast. And the people on America's east coast will tell you exactly where that hurricane landed. Now, this wouldn't be a very good science show if I gave you a sample size of one, so let's look at a few other examples. In 2015, the European model accurately predicted Hurricane Joaquin would miss the east coast, and then in 1993, it correctly forecast a nor'easter, which was called the storm of the century. So probably a good thing it got that one right. I think you get the point. Time and again, the European model outperforms the American model. When these two systems differ, forecasters just have to go with their gut. If it were me, my gut, I would say every time that it was going to be cloudy with a chance of meatballs. But man, I'm hungry. I haven't had lunch yet. Making accurate weather predictions also comes down to the location of the weather stations. Cities often have more stations than rural places, which means more data to use for those weather models compared to the sparsely populated areas. So forecasters might be predicting weather over the same sized area, but for cities, they're working off of more data than they are with rural locations. As Edward Lorenz showed in his work on chaos theory, the outcomes are very sensitive to initial conditions. So what might seem like a slight change or just a little less data at the beginning can generate very different results in the predicted weather. Now, that's not necessarily a deal breaker for those living outside of cities. I just told you a whole bunch of reasons why predicting the weather isn't as accurate as we'd all like it to be. We can't collect certain data when planes are grounded, there are unpredictable systems constantly in play, there's competing computer models, and a finite number of weather stations and data. It sounds like a Sisyphean task to me, but meteorologists still press on despite working in uncertain territory. I think really we should be more thankful that the forecasts we do have are as accurate as they are. And if you're not, I have a little secret for you. 5 and 7 day forecasts are actually right the vast majority of the time, like 80 to 90% of the time. Yeah, you heard me. I'm defending your local weather guy. They're an easy target, but it's not their fault that the future beyond the next couple of days is inherently a chaotic mess of math and hailstorms. Even so, their forecasts are actually getting better all the time. In fact, today's 6 day forecast is about as accurate as a 5 day forecast was 10 years ago. And 10 years from now, our 7 day forecast might be as accurate as our current 6 day forecasts, and so on and so forth. While I've told you that the forecast is pretty reliable and accurate now, there are still going to be some people out there who just don't agree. And some of that might be down to a misunderstanding about how to actually interpret those forecasts. Have you ever had your weather app tell you there's a 30% chance of rain, so you bring your umbrella and galoshes just in case, and then hour after hour, lo and behold, beautiful, clear, sunny skies, no rain in sight. Well, what if it did rain 5 kilometers away at your friend's house? The forecast was right for your friend, but not for you. It all depends on a person's point of view. It's a little case of NIMBYism, or not in my backyardism, but, you know, with weather instead of, like, large industrial projects. No feathers ever seem to get ruffled when the temperature is off by a few degrees. I mean, how often are you staring at a thermometer to double check that it exactly matches the forecast? Really, the pain and anguish always seems to come when it involves rain or snow. And that makes sense, really, it does. If you were told there was a 20% chance of snow and it snowed a lot, but you didn't have your galoshes on, you might be upset. You might call the meteorologist mean names, least of which would be to call them wrong. But if you knew how the chance of precipitation was calculated, you might feel differently. The US National Weather Services defines the probability of precipitation as the chance of rain or snow occurring at any one spot in the area covered by the forecast. Meteorologists use an equation which helps put that into perspective for you. It's P equals C times A, or the probability of precipitation equals the meteorologist's confidence that it will rain, that's the C, times the percentage of the area that is expected to get rainfall. So if a meteorologist is 50% confident that 100% of your neighborhood will get rain, then there's a 50% chance of rainfall. Conversely, if they think there's a 100% chance that 50% of your neighborhood will get rain, that's still going to show up on your weather app as a 50% chance of rain. To make it even more complicated, meteorologists can't agree that this is how the percentage should be calculated. One meteorologist actually says the probability of precipitation, quote, measures the likelihood that you'll see rain at any given point within the forecast area within a 12-hour time period. It's a slight difference, but the difference matters. Also, if you live somewhere that has microclimates, a place where the weather can be drastically different just from one part of town to the next, like, say, San Francisco, interpreting your forecast can get a little dicey. It's all much more complicated than the little symbols and numbers on your weather app might lead you to believe. Now, you could even argue, if you wanted to get hyperbolic, that meteorologists are playing a high-stakes game of roulette or poker or craps or, you know, whatever game you want to choose. Yeah, they've got supercomputers, they've got years of fine-tuned weather models, millions of measurements that get fed into those models, that's all working on their side. But there's still one important consideration. Both weather forecasts and high-stakes gambling, well, it requires a refined sense of interpretation that's aged and polished with experience. So when meteorologists spot a storm ahead, they can confidently listen to their gut. But could they predict the weather if someone was controlling it? We'll get into that in the next episode, but for now, we're going to end part one there. Next time you want to trash the weather forecast, though, think again. There's so much that goes into something that we take for granted every day, and more often than not, it's actually right. If there is a scientific topic or a puzzling question that you want to know more about, well, we probably do too. Let us know some of your questions in the comments. I promise we're putting it all in a big list and picking our favorites. So be sure to subscribe if we cover something you suggest, and I'll see you for the next Seeker Plus.